Hi folks, it's Dr. P. I want to do a quick example of a five variable K-map where we are solving for a product of sums expression. So I have written down the product of minterm or the sum of minterms for this. So we know that the minterms tell us which of these cells are going to be ones, and the don't cares tells us which ones are going to be X's. So all of the remaining cells are going to be zero. So the first step is to put in our ones, 13, 22, 23, 29, 30, and 31, 15 and 28 are don't cares, and everything else is gonna be a zero. So filling out the K-map, that's the simple part. Then what we wanna do is we wanna find every single prime implicant for our product of sums. So we're looking for all of our zeros. We're gonna find the biggest possible loops that we can make that are zeros and powers of two. So this one's a little tricky. Personally, if I were to solve this and I could choose between SOP and POS, I'd pick SOP because there's way fewer ones than there are zeros. So that's just a little bit simpler. But I'd like to do this as an example because it kind of helps you find a lot of kind of tricky loops that we don't see on four variable K-maps. That's why five variable K-maps are tricky. So we want to find every prime implicant. So we can start by looking for the biggest loops we can make. And I usually take the approach of start on the left, find the biggest loops I can make, and then ask myself if I can mirror them on the right-hand side. And if I can, then it's what I call a 3D loop, where we have that kind of like, it's kind of looping between the left-hand side and the right-hand side. So I can see two burritos that I can make on the left-hand side. So one of the burritos that I can make is 2, 3, 6, 7, 10, 11, 14, 15. This one's nice. It does not see its reflection in the right-hand side, so that's as big as it gets. This, in terms of Boolean algebra, is equal to A plus D prime. Okay, the A's are zeros everywhere. B changes, C changes, D changes, or D is one and E changes. So that's one of our prime implicants. The other burrito that I see is 0, 1, 2, 3, 8, 9, 10, 11. And interestingly enough, this burrito sees its reflection on the right-hand side, so it becomes what I call a 3D loop. Right, so that one may be a little bit tricky if you aren't kind of looking at this center line as a line of reflection. So if we look at the Boolean algebra value for this, we see that A changes, B changes, C is zero, D changes, and E changes. So the value of that loop is just equal to C. So that's a really nice prime implicant, right? It's really, really nice and big. So let's see what else we can get on the left-hand side and see again if it gets mirrored in the right-hand side or not. So I have minterm or max terms 5 and 12 that still haven't been looped. So I definitely have to think about what are all the different ways I could loop 5 or 12. So one of the ways that I could loop 5 is looping it with 1, 3, and 7. So 1, 3, 5, and 7 is one of my loops, one of my prime implicants. And this is equal to A plus B plus E prime. Another way that I can loop 5, and this again is kind of a tricky one to see, I can loop 1 and 5 with 17 and 21. So this is kind of a goofy one because you kind of have to think like three-dimensionally here. So this one here, this specific one that I just looped, man, that one's kind of tricky, which is why practicing with these can be very, very, very helpful. So we take a look, we see that B is a zero, C changes, D is a zero, and E is a one. So that's gonna be B plus D plus E prime. So that was every single way that I can loop 5. I still have 12, so let's loop that. The biggest loop, the prime implicant that I can make, actually there's two prime implicants I can make. One of them is gonna be this loop here. So here A changes, B is equal to one, C changes, and D and E are both equal to zero. There's one more prime implicant that I can make with max term 12. The last prime implicant that I can make with max term 12 is 8, 10, 12, 14. Okay, so that would be one that we could have made if this had been a four-variable k-map. So here A is equal to 0, B is equal to 1, C changes, D changes, and E is equal to 0. So at this point, we found all of the prime implicants on the left-hand side and all of the PIs that are kind of on the left and the right, the ones that find their reflection in that mirror. So what we have to do is we have to look at the right-hand side and see if there's anything left. And in fact, we do have max term 20, and there's two prime implicants I can include that have 20 in it. The first one is that pretty straightforward burger, so 16, 17, 20, 21, where A is equal to 1, B is equal to 0, C changes, and D is equal to 0. The last prime implicant that we can make with max term 20 is actually, again, another one that doesn't see its reflection on the left-hand side. Otherwise, we would have already found it. So this one is just that hot dog here with 16, 20, 24, and 28. So A is equal to 1 everywhere on this loop. And then B changes, C changes, D is 0, E is 0. So we have found all 8 prime implicants. At this point, we're ready to make our prime implicant table to figure out which are our essential prime implicants and which terms we need to include in our final expression. Here's our prime implicant table for our expression. Remember that we don't include don't cares here because we don't care if the don't cares are included or not. So the first thing that we want to do anytime we get a prime implicant table is to determine which columns, in other words, which max terms are only covered by a single prime implicant. So I'm going to use my highlighter here to identify the columns or the max terms that only have a single prime implicant covering them. And that is going to lead us to our essential prime implicants. So I always start on the left-hand side. And what I found is that C is an essential prime implicant. So I know that C is going to be included in my expression. C gets a lot of max terms out of the way for me. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 8, 9, 10, 11, 16, 17, 18, 19, 24, 25, 26, and 27. So that was a nice, very efficient prime implicant for us to do. At this point, we only have one more highlighted column left. So we're going to look at this one, 6, and find that A plus D prime is also an essential prime implicant. And that takes care of max terms 6, 7, 14. We've got four more max terms left. So we need to deal with max terms 5, max term 12, max term 20, and max term 21. We'd like to find something that kind of eats up as many of these as possible. And the only one that does that is going to be A prime plus B plus D. It's not essential, but it's the most efficient of our remaining prime implicants. So we're going to include that. And that's going to deal with 20 and 21. Now we just have max terms 5 and 12 left. So here we actually have four different possibilities as far as the prime implicants that we can choose. There is not a single prime implicant that covers both 5 and 12, unfortunately. So there's going to be a bunch of different ways that we can do this. Here are the four different possible expressions that I could come up with. The first one would be using A plus B plus E prime to deal with max term 5 and A plus B prime plus E to deal with max term 12. The next possibility would be to use A plus B plus E prime to deal with max term 5, but B prime plus D plus E to deal with max term 12. Next possibility is using B plus D plus E prime to deal with max term 5 and A plus B prime plus E to deal with max term 12. And the last possibility is B plus D plus E prime to get 5 and B prime plus D plus E to get 12. So again, really great example because it helps you really spot those patterns that we can get on a 5-variable K-map. It's good practice for a prime implicant table. And once again, it really highlights the fact that we can have four equivalent Boolean algebra expressions that look very different from each other, reminding us that the only way to tell that these are equivalent is by using a truth table. All right, folks, until next time, stay well.